Let's pray.
Holy Father in heaven, hallowed be thy great and matchless name. We're so thankful, God, to be here this evening. We're thankful to be here together, to gather, to listen a lesson from your word, to hear the wonderful words of life. So I pray, God, that we be connected tonight with the lesson, we be challenged in our Christian walk, and we're so thankful for the men here stepping up to teach our summer series. We're thankful for all who teach, our children, those who teach adult classes, just all those that teach, and we're just so thankful for the power of your word. Pray for Scott. Pray he brings the message boldly this evening. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Well, nobody introduced me. I was born at a very early age. In fact, I was 2 months early. And I weighed 3 pounds and 7 ounces, but you can't tell. I got over that. So, tonight's topic is Enrich. What is Enrich? I know that we've had other lessons on it already, so I actually, I wasn't in when Jerry Lundy spoke about it, so I was like, what did you talk about anyway? So I had him send me his notes so that I didn't want to trod on his path that he took. The perspective we'll take tonight is that to enrich is to fine-tune. To enrich is to grow in wisdom, to grow in love. It's to have the fruit of the Spirit in increasing measure. It's about having the tools to be more than just a babe in Christ. It's about having the motivation to be more than just a toddler in Christ. Okay? It's about having the understanding to be more than just a kid or a teen in Christ. You get where I'm going with that, right? Enrich is going to be about maturing. It's going to be about maturing in the Word. It's going to be about Bible study. It's going to be about encouragement. It's going to be about humility and priorities. But what I'm afraid of is, and what scares me most about Enrich, is the idea that, you know what, we're just good where we are. That attitude. You know, I'm afraid that we don't look at our Christian walk, our Christian life, as a journey of becoming more and more and more like Christ. Instead, we look at it as the highway to heaven. You know what I'm saying? It's the highway to heaven. We get on the highway, and we're good. You know, I'm pointing in the right direction, I'm good. I can put the cruise control on. You know, we get on this highway to heaven, we're good. All we care about is, are we pointed in the right direction? Are we moving? Are we consistent on this journey? Are we making some headway? Are we getting bogged down? Do we have to stop? Do we run out of gas? You know, as long as we don't, like, drive off the side, we'll be okay. And we stick the cruise on. And that is what I'm afraid of, is a metaphor that we use to describe our Christian walk, when that's, like, the wrong metaphor. That's not the metaphor I want to be talking about. I want to speak about the metaphor of growing from a baby to an adult. Okay, I'm going to suggest that when we quit wanting to enrich ourselves spiritually and grow in this spiritual journey, that we become malnourished. That we have hampered, impeded, hindered our growth. And that, real basically, that if we have decided that we need to quit being enriched, there's something wrong. There's something wrong. Here's the problem. We get to choose to be enriched or not. That's a problem. I mean, wouldn't it be a lot better if we were just forced to grow? I just want us to be careful not to mix our metaphors, thus fooling ourselves into thinking that cruise control is a good thing. So I want to give you a little illustration. I talked to a guy this past Monday, and I was talking to him, and I knew that would happen. I would lose it on here. I was talking to him, and this is what he said. He told me that he gave a guy a large sum of money just so he could invest in the guy's business so that he could just hang around that guy. Okay? He gave him the money with a clause, and the clause said this: I'll invest in your business, okay? But I get to eat lunch with you once a month. Can we just pause here and say, that was an expensive lunch? We're talking over $100,000. Here's what he said about that guy. He said, that guy, he is an awesome person. Okay? He is an awesome businessman, and he is an awesome Christian. I want to be around that guy. So on his Facebook, I went and saw a picture where he was at lunch, and he took a selfie of him and this long table of people, and here's what he called it: lunch with people better than me. And if I had his little Facebook thing queued up where I could find it fairly quickly, I would read it to you, and it'd say something like this. And this is kind of his little quote for the day, I guess. But he goes, "You're the average of the five people you hang around the most." So I guess what he's trying to say is, you better watch who you hang around, because that's who you're going to end up being like. And because he knows that, guess what he tries to do? He tries to hang around people that are going to help benefit him in his life journey. Okay? In business, and just the kind of person he is and the kind of Christian he is. And he told me that, and I went, man, that's kind of enriching. I didn't say that out loud. But do you see what he's doing? He told me this not because he was trying to impress me. He told me this because we were just talking about, you know, what's going on in life. How are you? How are things going? He wanted to impress on me the importance of the people that are around us. So when we begin to think about becoming enriched in the church setting, you know, have we forgotten the value of God? Have we forgotten the value of just coming and being in His presence? Have we forgotten the value, have we forgotten to take on His values? Have we forgotten to make His business our business? If I can say it using the kind of the picture of what that guy did. You know, he invested in somebody else's business so that he could be around them. It cost him something to hang around this person, to let that guy's values continue to rub off on him. Have we forgotten the value of God, the value of being in His presence, the value of taking on His values, of making His business our business? Let's pray. Let's pray. Our Father, hallowed be Your name. And I know we think of You in heaven, and we just want Your name to be sacred. God, I want the name of Jesus to be sacred here on this earth. God, I want the things that are in this room to be like they are in heaven, where everybody respects Your word, where people tremble when You speak. Father, I just want people to know how awesome You are. I don't want them just to know in their head, Father. I want them to know in their heart. I want them to know inside of them with every ounce of their being. Father, we take Your word so casually, Sometimes we get so arrogant thinking that we have profound thoughts. Father, I know that we live among people where everybody feels like their voice should be heard. But Father, it's your voice that needs to be heard. We want your name to be lifted up among the people. We want things on earth as they are in heaven. And Father, we don't want to covet. We just want our daily bread. For we know that it's not for this world, Lord. This world is not what matters. And so in this world, Father, just give us what we need. And may we be thankful for those gifts that you do give us. And Father, forgive us. Forgive us when we treat you casually. Forgive us when we seem to put other things in front of you so easily. Forgive us when, even when we're in the process of putting you first, we just kind of forget why we're here and just go about our business. Father, forgive us when we treat your word casually. Father, I pray for all of us that are in this room that you would lead us away from temptations. God, there's so many parts of us that are sick. There's so many things that we struggle with, that we fight against. Those thoughts that go through our mind. I know that you know when we have those. And Father, I know that those thoughts are disgusting to you. They're even saddening to you. Father, lead us away from temptation and deliver us from the evil one. Father, I pray that tonight something significant would happen. I pray that the significance is found that we appreciate your word, that we're encouraged by your word, that we're touched by your word, that we become more and more pockets of people here on this earth who exemplify you, who love your word even when others hate it, who are not ashamed of the gospel and not afraid to say something to our neighbors, to our friends, to our coworkers. But God, some of us are just really tired. We're tired of fighting. Father, help us not to grow weary. Help us not to grow cynical, not to grow angry, and not to lose our faith. We've come together as one through the washing of our sins away, through the resurrection of your Son, Jesus. And Father, may we agree on these things. May we agree on the influence and the power of your word. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So I am 53 years old. And I became a Christian at the age of 11. November 22nd, on my mama's birthday. And hands down, this has been one of the toughest years I've ever had. It's been one of the craziest years I've ever had. You know, I look at everything that's going on, not just from my perspective, but even from maybe yours. And this world is just crazy. I mean, I can tell you stuff from my life. You can tell me stuff from your life. You can tell me stuff from the lives of people in your family, and I can do the same. We can sit here and say, can you believe what happened in Oklahoma this year? What they passed? We could talk about this city. We could talk about this state, this country, this world, and we could just step back and go, it is unreal. Who would have ever believed that some of the topics that we need to address in our churches, you know, 20, 30 years ago, we thought, no way. No way. Seriously? And we hear about it over and over and over. We hear about people walking away from God over and over. We turn around and we're like, well, where's so-and-so? Yeah, and then we find out, and we're like, what happened? What happened? We hear about it over and over, people walking away from God, changing their views on stuff. Changing their views. Changing churches. They're either done, calling it quits, or they're changing their doctrine, their views, so that they can fit in. That's kind of a giving up right there, isn't it? And it becomes disheartening. It does. It becomes disheartening. And as I sit around trying to figure all this stuff out, you know, and I love our elders because we try to figure this stuff out. I love our church leaders, our deacons, our Bible class leaders, our teachers. I love this church family. And I'm praying about and trying to figure out, what does our church family need to be enriched? What do we need right here and right now? How do we need to be enriched? How do we need to be encouraged? How do we need to be trained or equipped in this crazy time? I mean, I had somebody walk up to me today. Hey, I got some equipping. That's what we're talking about, right? You were talking about equipping. And here's one thing that I pray for each of us. And I don't want to sound too weird on this. I pray that every single one of us in this room right here have and find a strong Christian best friend. You know what I'm talking about? I pray that every one of us finds that deep relationship that's connected to us, that we're connected to in good times and in bad times. Somebody that you'll rearrange your schedule for, somebody that you'll skip the game for, that you'll go to make sure you have a meal with, or you may put off a meal just to go be with them. Somebody that you'll be out money for. Somebody that there's not even a question. You need it. It's there. Somebody that you would risk your life for. I pray that every single one of us in here has a good, strong Christian best friend. You know what that means? Yeah, you already know what I'm going to say, don't you? You got to be one. I could say it the opposite. I pray that every single one of y'all and myself, okay, every single one of us is a good, strong Christian best friend. Now, you don't have to have 25 best friends. And I'm not saying get rid of any of the best friends you have. I'm just saying, can't we have at least one strong Christian best friend? I pray for you a strong Christian best friend, and I pray that you are one to somebody, because we have got to make it to the end of this journey. Okay? We have got to mature from being a toddler to an adult. I want you to think about this passage, and if you would, take your Bibles and open up to Matthew 24. We're going to begin in verse 9. Then you will be handed over to be persecuted and put to death. And you will be hated by all nations because of me. At that time, many will turn away from the faith and will betray and hate each other. And many false prophets will appear and deceive many people. Because of the increase of wickedness, the love of most will grow cold. But the one who stands firm to the end will be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come. You know what struck me about this passage? The word many. You will be handed over to be persecuted. You will be put to death. You'll be hated on my account. And at that time, many will fall away. and betray one another and hate one another. Many false prophets will appear. Many will be deceived. And because lawlessness, because wickedness will increase, the love of many will grow cold. And as I struggle with this, as I wrestle with this, with people just walking away, I hadn't really noticed this before. But you ready for this? This is not profound, but it kind of feels like it to me. Yeah, that's what's going to happen. That's what's going to happen. Jesus said that's what's going to happen. How disheartening. But it happens for several reasons. Verse 9, then you will be handed over to be persecuted and put to death, and you will be hated by all nations because of me, and many are going to walk away. Did you see what that is? Why will many people walk away? Avoid persecution and fit in. Yeah, they're going to walk away because it doesn't feel good. It's easier to what? To walk away? It appears easier. Do you know why many will walk away? It's because they'll be hated. That's part of it. They'll be hated. And remember, this is Jesus speaking, okay? Forget about all the opinions you've heard. Here's what Jesus says. There is going to be hatred toward Christians. I almost said newsflash, but it's not a newsflash, but it is a newsflash. We've seen it on the news. There's going to be hatred toward Christians because of the name of Jesus. There is going to be hatred toward Christians because of Christians' morality. There's going to be hatred because of the teaching out of this book, the Bible. There's going to be hatred towards Christians because we teach there's only one way to go to heaven. And that's through Jesus Christ. There is no other way. Do you understand what Jesus is saying? Have you ever felt hatred directed toward you? Because of your Christianity. Now, the reality is that some of us here in this room will feel hatred by the world against us. Okay? And you may be one of them. And you will be tempted to walk away. You'll feel it. And it may come in disdaining looks, and it may come like this. Christians just aren't loving. And you'll be tempted to pack your spiritual bag and hit the road. You have to ask yourself this question, ready? Am I being hated? Am I being hated? And I'll tell you, I don't like being hated. I don't like being disliked. I have a weird thought. I think everybody should like me. Seriously, it hurts my feelings if I think somebody doesn't like me. I'm like, I need to go talk to them because I think I'm pretty much convince them that I'm a good guy, right? I'm likable. And I think that if you'd get to know me, you would like me too. We have to seriously take this to heart. Are we okay with being hated? Say that again. And I'm assuming you're meaning by somebody, by God. We are on his side, and we're going to look at a verse, if we have time and get around to it, that'll say exactly what you're talking about. Because it'll say something like this, so this is a preview. What are you surprised about? They're hating you. They hated me first. Yeah.
But it does talk about enemy. Are we seriously okay with being that?
Because I'm telling you, some people, when they get that hatred, when they get that bad feeling toward, they're not going to put up with it.
Are we more into pleasing our mate than pleasing God?
Are we more into pleasing our boss than pleasing God? Are we more into pleasing our family members than pleasing God, our parents, our friends? Are we more worried about what our friends are going to think when we go out on just a fun evening? And then all of a sudden, the funness has a morality problem. And they're like, what does it matter? Come on, you're an adult.
Do we care more about what they think? Is it more important to be friends than to share with somebody that their lifestyle is in opposition to God?
Here's what Jesus says. If the world hates you, this is John 15, 18 and 19. If the world hates you, keep in mind that it hated me first. If you belong to the world, it would love you as its own. As it is, you don't belong to the world. But I have chosen you out of the world. That's why the world hates you. So what's the only way that you can be loved by this world? Yeah. If you give up being part of God's and be part of theirs.
By becoming a person of the world. And Jesus says,
hey, look at me. Okay, look at me. They hate me. And then can I just add a little bit? You'll be okay.
1 John 3:13. Do not be surprised, my brothers and sisters, if the world hates you. So again, I ask, are we okay with being hated?
Do we actually struggle with this? And do we see the need for continuing training in righteousness? Can I just say the word? Do we feel the need to continually be enriched? Y'all remember way back when, I think it was Carl Burkeen and Faulkner, they had come out with like marriage enrichment. They came out with these marriage enrichment videos and we're all like, I don't need that. Right, honey? It was like almost embarrassing if we wanted to go. Well, I'm not going for me. I'm going because, you know, my friends need to go. It's like we don't want to admit, we don't want to say that we need some training. We don't want to say that we need some enrichment. But I also kind of want to throw out there the idea, if you aren't enriching or continuing the training, you're malnutritioned. There's something wrong.
So here's a passage of Scripture. We have to be okay with being hated without giving hatred in return. Y'all heard that, right? We have to be okay with being hated without giving hatred in return. If we haven't been physically persecuted, I'm almost sure that we felt this other type of emotional persecution. Okay, whether it's from our family, our dear friends, our ex-friends, congregation members, ex-congregation members.
I'm almost certain that we felt some kind of hatred because we're trying to be Christ-like. And it's tough. So we ask ourselves, am I one of these people that's going to get really pushed by this hatred? And am I going to be tempted to just walk away?
Will it ever get so painful to stand up for Jesus that I just give up? Okay, turn to Hebrews chapter 13. Here's a passage of Scripture that might help.
Lee, when does the bell ring?
Okay, good. Hebrews 13, verse 12, 13, and 14.
And so, Jesus also suffered outside the city gate to make the people holy through his own blood. Let us then go to him outside the camp, bearing the disgrace he bore. For here, we do not have an enduring city, but we're looking for the city that is to come. Can I just say this? This is an awesome verse. Okay? What the author of Hebrews is saying is that Jesus had to suffer outside the gates of the city. Jesus couldn't be crucified in the city because the city was too sacred for that. Jesus couldn't be crucified within the city because Jesus was garbage to them. Jesus was a criminal to them. Jesus was a blasphemer and deserved to die. And they were going to crucify him and hang him on a tree, and he would become this cursed object, and we cannot have that type of cursed object in our holy city. Take him outside the city. And that's where their crucifixions were. So Jesus is pushed outside the city where all the rubbish is, where all the discarded material is. Let's kick him out of the city. He wasn't accepted there. And so the Hebrew writer says, let's go out to where he is. And let's go be with him. He says in verse 13, let us then go to him outside the camp. And listen to this part. Bearing the disgrace he bore. Bearing the disgrace he bore. If you're going to kick my Savior out of the city, I'm going with him. If you're going to kick him out of the city, I'm going to go to the foot of the cross. Because this city is not where it's at. And he's pointing right at Jerusalem, right? Can I point at Broken Arrow and say the same thing? This city is not where it's at. There's another city coming. Isn't there? I need the cross. And I'm going to stand here with him at the cross. And I'm going to endure the reproach that he endured. I love that passage. And we can all ask God to help us have that kind of heart, saying to the Father that whatever they say to you, they say to me. If they call you that, they're calling me that too. I'm with you. I am with you through thick and thin. I'm going to kneel right here at the cross. I am going to be crucified with Christ. Verse 9, back in Matthew. Then you will be handed over to be persecuted and put to death, and you will be hated by all the nations because of me. And also, he says in verse 11, and many false prophets will appear and deceive many people. So one, persecution is going to come. Hatred is going to come. Christians are going to say, I don't want to be hated. I'll change my view on that. So I can be accepted. And two, many false prophets will arise and lead many astray. So it kind of seems like there's going to be this whole boatload of people who've got their own opinion that they need to throw it out there. That's not God's opinion. Well, let me tell you how to be a good person. And so they start tweeting it out and they start Facebooking it out and they start blogging about it. And next thing you know, anybody who wants to find something on spirituality doesn't go to the Bible. They go to the internet. They go ask their best friend what they think. They go ask their schoolmate what they think, or their boss, or somebody that, you know what, this person went to the Far East and now they came back and they had some really cool things to say. Can I remind you of a scripture you already know? Isaiah 55, verse 8 and 9. My thoughts, says the Lord, are not like yours. And my ways are different from yours. As high as the heavens are above the earth, so high are my ways and my thoughts above yours. Okay, God's just saying, let me make this clear. Okay, let me make this clear. And here is God, the creator of the universe. Okay, get this picture in your head. This creator of the universe. And he wants to say something to us. So he comes in past that farthest galaxy, and he keeps heading on in, and he finally gets to our galaxy, and he keeps on heading in past those planets and past those stars, and he finally comes to our star, the sun, and he gets here, and he finds the right planet, and he comes down to this planet, and he goes, you know the way I think? It's nothing like what you're thinking about. And the things that I have planned, my ways, man, they're not yours. You know how far away they are? Then you'd have to get on his back and ride with him all the way back out to that farthest galaxy. What I do know is everybody thinks they have this word that needs to be listened to. And everybody feels like their voice needs to be heard. I've come up with some awesome profoundness. Can I just say this? This is the awesome profoundness. Okay, this is it. Can you imagine? He said, my thoughts and my ways are that far above you. Guess what? Here they are. Okay, you want to be enriched. You got to get in here. You got to get in here. Now, here's what I know. You can get enriched with your own personal Bible study at your house. Please do. You got to get enriched by being part of it. But you know what God also does? God also calls us to be a part of this body. Okay, so the elders and the leaders of this church has tried to figure out, how can we enrich each other? And there's lots of different ways that this body right here in Broken Arrow has done that, is trying to do that. And there needs to even be different and more ways. And what I mean by that is, I know we have Bible classes. We have Bible classes on Sunday and on Wednesday. We have life groups. We have ladies' Bible classes. We have study groups. We have people studying you may not even know they are. And they're using each other's insight, but they're getting into the Bible because that's what matters. God says, my thoughts are so not your thoughts. Okay? It's almost, and you might have heard this. I heard the bell, but I need to end by saying this. It's almost like this dad talking to this toddler going, you know, you just don't get it. You know? You don't have a clue about going to work, little Mr. two-year-old. You don't have a clue of what it takes to make a meal. So while we're thinking that stuff through, you go on and have your toddler thoughts. But it's not, it is that bad. I mean, it is that bad. But it's not like we can't really understand things. His thoughts are right here. Okay, we need to continue to be enriched by what God has given us, not by what man made up. And we certainly don't need to be afraid of the world. And therefore, let that scare us off. I had two more points I'm going to make, but I'm not going to make them because we're out of time. Thank you for being here. We're going to have a brief moment before we have our devotional. So we will end with this. Thank you.